I'm Gary Knoll. You're listening to the Progressive Radio Network, and for all of our sister stations, including WBAI, we have a very special one-hour special for you. It's on the COVID-19 virus. Now, it's going to be in two parts. You'll only be able to hear today one part if you're listening over a sister station. But if you're listening on PRN, you'll be able to hear both. And here's what it is. Everything that we can reasonably do to build up our immune system using natural, non-toxic techniques, I'm going to share with you. And it's all based on quality science. This is all from the peer-reviewed literature. And then, so that's a whole hour. And then I brought together some of the world's leading experts. We're talking about mainstream scientists. None of these are holistic doctors. And I have a whole plethora of topics they're going to be talking on about how accurate are the death statistics. They're not at all. How good is the antibody test that we're all taking, supposedly to tell us whether we had the virus or not? It's very inaccurate and unscientific. Well, how good is that aggressive over-medical therapy they've been giving people throughout the first part of this COVID pandemic? Well, it's caused a lot of people to die unnecessarily. And so what have we got right or wrong? That's what you'll be listening to. A very important hour. And I trust them because they're not financial. They don't own the patents on vaccines. They're not trying to push a vaccine. They're just trying to tell us what they've learned. And it's very revealing. So you're going to hear a lot. That's our program. Now, to the latest on how we can build up our immune system naturally. Now let's go to Richard Gale, because Richard and I have been working on what can we do to build up our immune systems now? Because the one thing that is certain when everything else is in question, and that is, are you less likely or more likely to have adverse effects from the COVID virus or any other virus or bacteria if you have a weakened immune system? Meaning if you're the average American eating the average garbage diet, you're not exercising, you're overweight, you have diabetes or prediabetes, or whether you're healthy, eating a healthy plant-based diet, exercising, de-stressing, detoxifying, juicing on a regular basis, taking proper supplements. Of course, all the science shows you're far more likely to stay healthy no matter what pathogen you come in contact with if you keep your immune system strong. Yet there is right now no effort to educate the American public on how to have a strong immune system. Richard, your thoughts?
Yes, Gary. We're focusing here on the coronavirus and what we can do to strengthen our immune system, not just with the coronavirus, but other viruses that we may come in contact with, such as particularly the flu virus and other kinds of respiratory illnesses, the Coxsackie virus. And there's a lot to be said for not just the different vitamins and supplements that we could be taking, minerals, but also for there's a wonderful arsenal of different herbal formulas and natural products from the natural world that could be taken to strengthen our immune system. A couple of the ones that have shown the most efficacy, particularly for the coronavirus infections and flu, one is astragalus. Astragalus is, there's some excellent research that's been conducted on astragalus as far as an antiviral, because most herbals have antibacterial properties, but here we're dealing with a virus. So many herbs cannot be properly called an antiviral, although they strengthen certain functions within our cellular immune system in order to combat viruses. But astragalus is one that has been shown to have antiviral activities, and it's actually very widely used throughout Asia for hepatitis infections. So this is, in fact, most of the research on astragalus's antiviral properties concerns hepatitis. and it's been widely used for hundreds, thousands of years in Asian medicine. What makes astragalus particularly strong is it has a family of compounds called saponins, and this is the particular compound that's been researched extensively. Even the U.S. Department of Agriculture's Avian Disease and Oncology Laboratory found that it inhibits avian flu viruses. China's, of course, has done the most study research into astragalus because it is a very common herb that's used in different traditional Chinese formulas. Jinlin Academy of Agricultural Sciences looked at it and found that it has antiviral properties that can treat bronchial conditions caused by avian coronavirus. There are different kinds of coronavirus, as many of you might know already, that could be transmitted through bats, through birds, through pigs, through other kinds of animals. But there is an avian coronavirus, and it's, and at least the research shows it's good for that. I don't know if there, I haven't found any current research for this very specific COVID-19 strain that's out there concerning astragalus's efficacy, though. In China, what's very interesting, even because China has such a large poultry industry, that they will they use astragalus as part of the chicken feed, and also in pig feed to ward off certain viruses that are associated with respiratory infections. There was it's a couple months ago now, the Beijing University of Chinese Medicine completed a large analysis of all the previous research that's been done on Chinese herbal formulas, including the SARS coronavirus, which was from the earlier epidemic to happen, and H1N1 swine flu. And there were several studies to show the efficacy of astragalus. So there's a very large body of literature that supports astragalus. And astragalus, of course, is not a particularly expensive herb to purchase. There are many, many different supplemental companies that make very good quality astragalus supplements. The very interesting ones, many of us will know that when we have a cough, sometimes drinking some licorice tea can be very helpful for soothing and clearing some of the bronchial tubes and all. And there's been a considerable amount of research done on licorice root. It's the primary compound is called glycyrrhizin acid. I'm not going to spell it. It's a very long word. And again, licorice has been used for hundreds, if not thousands of years in traditional medicines. Ancient Greece, you find licorice being used for treating respiratory tract infections and hepatitis, same for in China and in Japan. For 20 years, Japan has been using the derivative of licorice root, this glycyrrhizin acid, for treating hepatitis B and hepatitis C infections. And they've shown almost very rare, if any, side effects happen from just using this one particular compound that's found in licorice root. It's been shown to induce apoptosis in lymphoma cells, Kaposi sarcoma, that could be related to herpes virus. And Japan's National Institute of Infectious Diseases reported that licorice compound is effective against specifically coronavirus and for severe acute respiratory syndromes, also for Epstein-Barr syndrome. So for Epstein-Barr, if you know anybody that gets a flu vaccine or something, have them immediately be drinking some licorice tea or something with licorice, real real licorice, not the artificial crap that they make candy out of and stuff. After one of the strongest studies, it was shortly after the deadly SARS outbreak in 2012, that a large study was done by Frankfurt University Medical School in Germany, and they were looking at different kind of antiviral compounds that they could identify in different plants for treating patients with the SARS infection. And of all the compounds that they tested, they found that it was the glycyrrhenicin acid in licorice that was the most effective amongst all of them. There's a good body of literature to support the benefits of licorice. The other one is elderberry. Now, the one wonderful thing about elderberry is that it does support immune function. It's not just strictly a compound that's going to target a bacteria or a virus that happens to infect us. It has a direct it supports our immune system, and that's what we're really kind of looking for in order to best protect ourselves from viral and bacterial infections. So we probably all know that elderberry, usually some what's called sambucus as a syrup, is very common to take when we come down with colds or have a flu infection, and it contains a body of a group of compounds, cyanogenic lysosides, that this is why it's very necessary and it's very important for people to understand that you want to be only taking elderberry as a syrup. You do not want to go out picking elderberries and then eating them because of this particular glycoside that can cause nausea or vomiting, cramping, diarrhea. So it's best to get only in syrup form, in which there's a kind of a high potency of the molecules that you really want to have the immune building function. Israel, a big study in Israel found that elderberry was effective for 10 different strains of influenza, as well as helping to regulate our body's cytokine activities. So, of course, our cytokines are our body's natural anti-inflammatory biomolecules. When we become infected or if we have any kind of inflammatory condition, our body produces these cytokines. But the danger is we do not want the body to produce too many cytokines, because then you have what's called a cytokine storm, and that can revert some of our body's systems into an autoimmune response. But when we do get infected with any kind of an infectious organism, our body will produce cytokines. So Hadassah University Hospital in Israel found that elderberry will help to regulate the cytokine activity so that you won't kind of go over a threshold into having a cytokine storm. And there was another Israeli study, a Hebrew university, published in the Journal of Internal Medical Research, that found that individuals who had existing flu-like symptoms, they were not, the study was only looking at people having flu-like symptoms, which includes coronavirus. So we're speaking of any kind of a virus. They weren't really looking at what virus the person had. But if they only took 15 milliliters of elderberry syrup four times a day, they recovered four times earlier, faster than any medication on the market or a placebo. So that was a good kind of good study, just for if you have a cold or because it could be a coronavirus. Remember that the common everyday cold that we've been getting since we were born is more often not is going to be some strain of a mild coronavirus. Emory University has done some good work on elderberries. And there was a large study out of National Sun Yat-sen University, that's in Taiwan. It's one of the better studies that looked specifically at sambucus as its potential antiviral properties against one of the coronavirus strains, and showed that it was effective. Now, many people think that echinacea is a wonderful, wonderful plant for helping to fight directly viruses or bacterial infections. However, the evidence for that is rather weak. What echinacea is better at building our immune system and preparing our immune system for any kind of potential infection. So it doesn't have specific antibacterial or antiviral properties. There are many, many different strains of echinacea, but if you look at a, if you're going to purchase echinacea, this kind of just a consumer advice. If you're going to purchase, it will on the ingredients, it will say what the strain is. So you always want to be certain it's Echinacea purpurea, P-U-R-P-U-R-E-A. That has been the best research of the different strains of echinacea is the one that has been shown to be most effective in targeting the most different kinds of infectious pathogens. So that's something to look for, because a lot of these companies could just be ripping you off and just getting any kind of a strain of echinacea, calling it echinacea and throwing it into the capsule. So you want to be certain that if you want a good quality echinacea, that it says Echinacea purpurea. As I said, it does have its limitations depending on the severity of an infection. So once a cold is caused by any one of these various kinds of cold viruses, including the coronavirus, and the more deeply that cold infects the bronchia and the lower lung, echinacea does not appear to be that helpful. Its strength is really on the very beginning of the onset of coming down with kind of any kind of a cold symptoms or whatnot. Again, another little piece of consumer advice. There was a Cornell University study that looked at the medicinal properties found throughout the different parts of the echinacea plant, leaves, the stems, the bark, the roots. And the scientists noted that only echinacea extracts to contain the root showed significant antiviral properties. So again, this is just a little piece of consumer advice. If you're purchasing echinacea, very often it will say echinacea root. Well, it says echinacea root good. If you're saying echinacea, it might be a leaf that's going to do absolutely nothing for you. So you want to be certain that you're looking at echinacea root. Olive leaf, Gary has suggested olive leaf many, many times as a very, very important biomolecule. It exhibits its antioxidant, it's anti-inflammatory. It's shown to have anti-cancer properties, antimicrobial. And one of the advantages of olive leaf is that it's very highly bioavailable in the body cells. So it's absorbed very easily by the body. So you're really getting the maximum benefit of it if you use olive leaf. And there are over 10,000 studies that are in the National Institutes of Health scientific literature looking at olive leaf or its most important biomolecule, which is called, if I could pronounce it, oleuropein, O-L-E-U-R-O-P-E-I-N, sometimes abbreviated as O-L-E. And that's the most important of the molecules. It's an antioxidant, antiviral, and an anti-cancer molecule in the olive leaf. There are a few studies that show olive leaf's effectiveness against respiratory viruses. The University of Auckland in New Zealand has did a study that suggested olive leaf can contribute to treating respiratory illnesses, including the coronavirus. The University of Hong Kong has also did an earlier study looking at the different antiviral properties in olive that were effective against flu and RSV or respiratory syncytial virus. Go through oregano oil. Oregano is another immune builder in the herbal class of plants and medicinal herbs. Oregano has a compound that's called carvacrol. And this has been shown to be has some antiviral properties, but again, it's more in helping the body cells to fight the virus. And it's been tested against several flus and flu and respiratory viruses, but I have not found any studies showing it's been tested specifically with the coronavirus. University of Putra in Malaysia did a very large meta-analysis looking at all the existing research of different plant essential oils and reported that oregano was perhaps one of the strongest against flu-like viruses and adenovirus and Coxsackie virus. There are several other botanicals if one wants to really protect themselves during the flu season or when there's an increase in respiratory infections. There's a plant we don't speak of much, but it's available. There's several companies that make it, and it's called Buplurium, Bupleurum. And this has been studied quite extensively in Taiwan. It's a plant that's found in a lot of Asian plant medicinal formulas. As I said, there are several companies that make this. I found them online. But this has been shown to have anti-coronavirus properties. There was a study at University of College Dublin. It was done along with Sichuan Agricultural University in China that looked at many of the different kinds of Chinese plants, specifically trying to find those that are going to be most promising against coronavirus. And the list that they came up with was ginseng, the licorice, and a plant that's called Isatis, I-S-A-T-I-S. Under different names. Sometimes it's called Asp of Jerusalem or WOAD, W-A-D. But those were the three that were found in combination to be showing the most promise against coronavirus and other respiratory infections. When we look at supplements, well, we all know that we're seeing that vitamin C is now being used not just intravenously, but orally as well. In China, in Wuhan, the Chinese Medical Academy, the kind of equivalent of our CDC, has been recommending vitamin C for intravenous for against coronavirus. So, unlike the United States, most of the world, especially in Asia and continental Europe, they truly recognize vitamin C as an important antiviral agent. You know, we just don't hear about that from our mainstream media, and our medical establishment just seems to refuse to acknowledge that. But when you go elsewhere in the world, that's not the case. It's pretty unique to the United States. And we all know it's a remarkable antioxidant for helping to ward off infections. And you see what else I could really speak about concerning that on vitamin C. There's plenty of research studies that have been done on vitamin C. University of Helsinki in Finland has probably become the kind of the hub of vitamin C research in recent years. And I've been finding many, many studies coming out of the University of Helsinki. And in 2017, they did a very large review they actually selected out 148 among probably thousands of studies done on vitamin C. But these were the studies that really met the gold standard of scientific methodology and review and conclusions. And it indicated that vitamin C can alleviate or prevent infections caused by bacteria and viruses. The most extensive indication study was, of course, the common cold. And among people who are physically active, vitamin C was found to be most beneficial. And in a way, that would kind of make some sense. There's some logic behind that. Because vitamin C, one of the big concerns many people have when you purchase vitamin C is how soluble of a form of vitamin C you're purchasing. Some molecules of vitamin C are less soluble than others. So if you are doing exercise along with taking vitamin C, you're going to be helping with the absorption rate of that vitamin C into your body, too, so you're not just, you know, urinating it out later. So this was a study that really showed that vitamin C is most beneficial when you are doing some form of exercise in combination with it. And unfortunately, I think in the vitamin C literature is these studies that kind of poo-poo vitamin C and say, oh, it's not really effective. But when you look at them and you look at them carefully, they're just giving the participants these very small doses, you know, like 100 milligrams daily, and that's it. And then they make these broad conclusions about vitamin C being ineffective for whatever they're studying it for. So but when you look at studies where they are using maximal doses and larger doses, you always find that it's effective. Vitamin D, we know the importance of vitamin D. There's barely a week goes by when I'm pulling the scientific studies out for Gary to do his daily broadcast of health news. There's barely a week goes by when another study about vitamin D doesn't appear somewhere in the peer-reviewed literature. And there's a high number of otherwise healthy adults have been reported to have low levels of vitamin D, and especially towards the end of the winter month when we're not outdoors much, there's less sunlight and all. So the majority of people really are vitamin D deficient, and the figures for vitamin D deficiency in the United States for the entire population is about 42%, almost 50%, and amongst African Americans, Blacks, and Latinos, it's actually much higher, because our absorption of vitamin C depends on different skin pigments. So this is probably one of the it's almost a scandal in the U.S. that our medical profession doesn't almost mandate. If we're going to mandate anything, let's mandate vitamin D supplementation rather than a vaccine, because the vitamin D is just so important for so many of the body's functions. And we have a crisis in this country of vitamin D deficiency. So, of course, we know that when we are vitamin D deficient, that we are at an increased risk in all autoimmunity illnesses. We are more susceptible to infection. When we have sufficient vitamin D, it boosts up our body's mucosal defenses. Okay, so again, this is to strengthen our immune system and our immune functions. And this is critical for protecting ourselves against infectious respiratory diseases. There was a large study by Harvard and Massachusetts General Hospital. It was a large global collaborative study. It was followed up with a Cochrane analysis, and it involved 11,000 participants. And it confirmed that vitamin D taken daily or even weekly significantly cut the risk of all respiratory infections by at least half. So that's a very, very, it's an important statistic to show the value of, be certain we get sufficient vitamin D. Of course, Gary can always talk much better and more eloquently than I can about how much vitamin C you really need in your body. Gary speaks about N-acetylcysteine. And again, this is very important for reducing oxidative stress. So when our bodies are being plagued with high oxidative stress, our immune system is going to suffer from that. And oxidative stress is well known to be a pathway, you could say, for our becoming more susceptible to different kind of microbial infections, such as viruses, or bacterial pneumonia, and especially in the lungs. So when the lungs are subjected to serious oxidative stress, there is an increase in these inflammatory cytokines that I mentioned before. And these different cytokines, they've been repeatedly shown in clinical research to play a role in different respiratory infections, including influenza, and which we read it in the literature, all the scientific literature concerning coronavirus. Therefore, these having a very, very effective antioxidant that specifically is helping to target to alleviate any possibility of lung damage due to oxidative stress that could be further triggered by having an infection. This N-acetylcysteine, which is like one of the most important ones that we could be taking for this, for building our immune system to protect our lungs. And the nice thing about N-acetylcysteine is that it benefits, it directly benefits, it's a direct antioxidant in a sense, rather than just an antioxidant that's only influencing other activities in the body that produce an antioxidant effect. It is a direct antioxidant.
Richard.
Yeah, Gary.
Let me intercede here for a little bit because we don't have all that much time, and I want to cover some other things, not repeat what you've said, and you've done a good job there. But colds and flu are with us all the time. It's not just seasonal, though we're more susceptible and have more of them when the winter comes, late fall, and when change of weather. That has to do for a lot of things. But we're looking larger at a larger picture, and that is the immune system. How do we as a nation get our immunity back up to where it should be so that no matter what pathogen we're faced with, a cold virus, of which there are more than 200 viruses that infect the upper respiratory tract, and they're spread through the air, which is one of the reasons we should be conscientious of even using masks, because a sneeze or a cough may not directly impact us, but if it hangs in the air or is on a surface and we then happen to touch that surface or shake someone's hand who's coughed in their hand, that's how we get it, because we touch our face so often. And we have always had cold viruses. There's no vaccine for any of them. And the foolishness of our flu vaccine, which they're now suggesting that people are going to get the regular COVID vaccine coming up, should start getting their flu vaccine now. That's the most unscientific, foolish notion you should have, because there's no proof that it really is that effective for any given person. So when we look at congesting our bodies and sneezing and coughing or sore throat, the kind of symptoms that people have, then what do? Well, you mentioned several, but here's overall. I'm going to give everyone right now an overall program of how to keep your immune system strong. No matter whether you're congested or have a non-productive dry cough or swollen lymph nodes or fatigue or you have a mild fever, the root causes are not just viral or bacterial. They can also be a lifetime burden of toxicity in your body. A lifetime deficiency of immune response. You could be nutritionally deficient. You could be living under high stress. As you just mentioned, oxidative stress. My vitamin C is very good for oxidative stress. And all this stems from just basics like eating light, eating clean foods, meaning locally grown organic, having lots of soups and broths, including fermented broths like miso. And a very tasty miso that's not high in sodium is a barley miso. It doesn't look dark because it's not. Barley is a light grain. But you can get brown rice miso, you can get soy miso. And then have each day either take a supplement of probiotics, because the probiotics in the billions directly impact your immune system, directly help your body deal with any kind of infection. So herbal teas, mate tea and green tea and oolong tea, white tea. These are all important. And if you can't have the teas, which I suggest people have, because then you could take an extra capsule of 200 to 500 milligrams of green tea and put some Manuka honey in, because Manuka honey is one of the best healing honeys of all. And I would even put a quarter of a teaspoon of raw organic bee from the bee's royal jelly. That helps your body. And also, we have to have better digestion. Better digestion means eating smaller amounts. Caloric restriction is one of the keynotes of long life. But also it helps us get through a day feeling lighter, not this kind of heavy emphasis upon overeating, always eating, always being full. So there's always digestion going on, which means we have caloric ingestion, and that's not good. Stay hydrated with plenty of clean water, but also juices, fresh-made juices, not drinks, but juices, and spike it. Put in some ginger, a garlic, always good for you. In fact, in miso soup, you can put garlic and onion and shallots, and then always have some lemon, honey, cinnamon. That is great to put into some hot water. You can have a hot tea with lemon, honey, and cinnamon. And then you got to avoid all your sugars, your processed sugars, because every time you have sugar, you decrease by up to 50% your white blood cells, and that is what your body produces to help your immune system, and so it depresses the immune system. So every time you have one of these soft drinks or you have a dessert with sugar, you've just put your immune system in a straitjacket. So you need healthy juices. Now, one of the best juices for helping your immune system would be your green juices. Celery, green apple, cucumber, and with some lemon, that is terrific for your immune system. Now, also, aside from a healthy diet with lots of berries, the full spectrum of berries, including pomegranate, which is good for you. If you can't get the fresh berries, because they're not always in season, you can get them frozen. Therefore, they are all in season. But if you want more power in your body, have the concentrate, because the concentrate is the juice where they've eliminated about one-third to one-half of the water, so you're getting more power. Pomegranate juice, beet juice, these are super good for you. Sauerkraut juice is good, or cabbage juice is also good. I would also recommend, along with that healthy diet, I would recommend some looking at some of the homeopathic remedies for flu and colds, and you mentioned echinacea and golden seal, and those are a combination of herbs that enhance the immune system, but also Lomatium dissectum, Lomatium dissectum, like 500 milligrams or 2 to 4 mLs of a tincture 4 times a day. And by the way, Lomatium is a very powerful and effective antiviral. I won't go into vitamin C, but I start vitamin C at 1,000 milligrams 4 times a day under normal circumstances. But when a person is sick, you got to understand vitamin C supports your immune system through increasing your white blood cell activity. So they're talking about, oh, gee whiz, let's get the white cells, let's get the T cells. Yeah, vitamin C does that and is proven to do that with no harmful side effects. And they're saying, well, the vaccine will do it. Well, why not do it by vitamin C? Because in 2 separate studies in China, intravenous vitamin C at 24,000 milligrams was able to protect all the thousands of people in the hospitals who had COVID without any of them dying, and they got better quicker. Zinc is very important. Now, for people who have sore throats, I suggest a zinc lozenge, because it's either zinc gluconate or acetate, and every 3 hours for about 3 days. That will help because of its immune function and its antiviral properties. You can also get a zinc nasal spray. Ginger is perfect. 500 milligrams of a capsule or drink, fresh tea 4 times a day, and just take 1 inch of ginger root and peel this outer skin and then boil it. Or you can juice it and then put the juice, a little tiny amount of juice, about 1/4 teaspoon, because it's very strong, and you put that in your tea or your shake, and that can help you if you have the throat problems or chills. Now, astragalus, A-S-T-R-A-G-A-L-U-S, astragalus, and I'm suggesting around 1,000 milligrams, or you can take a 3.0 milli of a tincture 2 or 3 times daily, It's an excellent for challenging the common cold, and also it's good if you have a fever. Now, you mentioned earlier oregano, and oregano oil is extremely powerful. I do not recommend taking it straight. I recommend you put it into a juice, and you could put in like 500 milligrams of oregano and take that like four times a day. You mentioned elderberry, Sambucus nigra. Elderberry is great. Again, as a liquid, I use it almost every day as a preventative, and generally one teaspoon. Garlic is good. It combats infections and really strengthens your immune system. Generally, I would say a teaspoon of garlic in a soup, or if you want to take it in that drink, you can take it in your drink, and you can also put some black cumin seed oil in there, a teaspoon, coconut oil, a teaspoon, and some bee propolis, which is a dark, thick paste. And something that is rarely used today but should be, I found it works in the people I work with, thymus extract. It optimizes your immune activity. Generally, you take one capsule twice a day. And there's an awful lot of good homeopathic remedies. Generally, you take two pellets at 30 C potency. I suggest maybe three times a day. And things for the upper respiratory tract would be Napellus, N-A-P-E-L-L-U-S. That would be good. But there's a lot of others, too, and you'd have to work with your homeopathic person. If you have nasal discharge or you have irritation in the nasal area, Allium, SEPA, S-E-P-A, Arsenicum album for colds with profuse, clear, watery discharge is good. And also Natrum Muriaticum is good for colds. Acupressure works as well. Body work is good. Hydrotherapy is important. Aromatherapy. Lavender has immune-boosting properties. I would definitely look at that. Eucalyptus and peppermint relieves congestion and stimulates circulation. And tea tree oil and Melissa oils are antiviral. And I use tea tree oil every day when I'm going out. I put it on the bottom of my, or not the bottom, on the sides of my tennis shoe, and ticks don't go up where I have that. I've never had a tick bite. But then, aside from this and the juicing, and I suggest six juices a day, and I mix both, have fruit juices like grapefruit, lemon, lime, and then also I might have a cleansing juice like watermelon with lemon, and then a green juice as well. But with a good diet and the proper supplements, I also suggest stress reduction. Because the more stressed you are, the more cortisol, epinephrine, norepinephrine, catecholamines you create. So the more stress hormones you create, the greater the challenge against your immune system. That's why when people are stressed, they almost always, shortly thereafter that stress, come down with a cold. So de-stressing with all the things you know how to do already, mindful meditation, yoga, deep breathing, listening to soothing music, putting on a, you know, you can go to your computer and look up soothing music like waterfalls or thunderstorms and just listen to it. Close your eyes and listen to it. But also I found the Bach, B-A-C-H, flower remedies are very important too, especially for any kind of common stress that leads to colds. And Bach's been around for a long time. So you want to get rest, an infrared sauna at 140 degrees for about 30 minutes. That really takes care of viruses in the body, and including the coronavirus. And so these are things that we can do to help our immune system, whether it's a cold, a flu, whatever virus you might be impacted by. So if you follow these things on a regular basis, then they act as a preventative and keep your immune system strong. Exercise also is important for strengthening the immune system, but not overdoing it. That's why people training for the New York Marathon, you ask them, you know, on marathon day when we're tens of thousands meeting there, they almost all have colds, the flu, their immune system's broken down, where all of our athletes, and we've trained over 32,000 to do the marathon, they've all done it, not one's not. we do it gradually, and we keep our immune system strong all the time, so we finish it and we're not burned out the next day. So these are some things we can do that are realistic, that can help our immune system, that are not being advocated. And you have to ask why. Why we have a Surgeon General, the National Institutes of Health, U.S. Public Health Service, we have the CDC, the FDA, the National Cancer Institute, the National Institute for Allergy and Infectious Disease, National Institutes on Aging, and none of them are talking about building your immune system within your own power, something you can do, the innate immune response. It's all the only thing they say is, if you want to be healthy, take a vaccine. And yet I'm looking at the scientific literature, you're looking at the scientific literature. We've done over about 50 articles on this, and they all show just the opposite. The millions of people throughout the world who've had adverse reactions to vaccines, and they're all pushed off the margins into oblivion like they didn't count. And we say we should pay attention to victims, and yet we never want to hear from a woman who's been victimized and their child has autism because of bad vaccines. And we say, trust your doctor. But when the doctor's a pediatrician, like their Dr. Palvitsky and some, who say these vaccines should not be used, we say he's a quack, he's no good. And yet he risks his career and his income to tell the truth. And you have to ask, how warped have we become? How degraded in our intellect are we when those who are in the front line of helping children maintain their health tell us the truth, and they're the ones whom we now condemn? That makes no sense. And yet the people you see on television all seem to have vested interest to sell us something in the way of a vaccine. So this is the information that can help us. So what we're going to do, we're out of time now, Richard. Do you have any final thoughts?
No. I mean, the one thing I would have wanted to bring up was the importance of having a very healthy microbiome and gut bacteria. That's, we've been reporting on this increasingly, and what's interesting is 10 years ago, it was like the rare study that came out. Now it's constantly reading all these new things about the importance of the microbiome, not just for our immune system, but for brain health and cardiovascular health, and the list goes on and on and on, and for our endocrine systems. So that's, emphasizing that part of our microbiome and all those other organisms, viruses and fungi and yeast and bacteria that live in our gut and elsewhere in our body. We are a literal zoo of microbes, and we forget there's good guys and bad guys. So it starts with really improving our microbiome so that we can be certain the bad guys are out and the good guys are in.
I agree. Are we willing to change our habits? Are we willing to alter our diet? Are we willing to start exercising or stress management techniques? That depends upon the individual. We've just given the information. My hope is that people realize this is the best protection you can have. If they should come up with a safe and effective vaccine, I would recommend it. I've never seen a safe or effective vaccine, but I'm open-minded to it. I believe in freedom of choice. There are medications that they're using which are safe and have been able to cure the coronavirus, but they're off patent, so they're inexpensive, $20, $50, and they're being downplayed or attacked by mainstream media. So when the mainstream media become the handmaidens of the pharmaceutical industry, you should no longer trust what they say. They're just lying. So thank you very much, Richard Gale. And for everyone listening, we're doing this program in two parts. For those of you who listen to Progressive Radio Network, you'll be able to hear both. For those of you listening to our syndicated stations around the world, you'll just hear this one on building the immune system. But now we're going to go into all the doctors and scientists and what they're saying about the coronavirus to give you a more honest look at what we're really facing. What do we know with some certainty, and what we're still not knowing concerning the COVID-19 virus? We know that it's a real virus, whether we've been able to prove thus far, which we have not, that it was humanly, let's say, engineered, and for what purposes, that is still an open question. that it's able to kill people, especially the most vulnerable in our population, that is a fact. That it is equally deadly to everyone, that has been completely disputed. That the reaction to it worldwide with the lockdown and quarantining was the wrong action. And was that politically or economically motivated? We don't know. But it was a foolish notion. It has disrupted people's lives, destroyed millions of businesses, and caused over 45 to 50 million people to lose their work. Many will regain their work, but probably, let's say, 20 to 30 million Americans may not in the near future. Part of the problem is, who do we trust? Who do we believe? On the one hand, we're asked to believe Dr. Anthony Fauci. In fact, he's so popular, he's about to throw out a baseball to open up the baseball season in Washington. And he is the darling of the media. He can do no wrong. The problem is, he's done a lot wrong. I was there at the beginning, back in the early 1980s, and from 84 on, when Anthony Fauci, through the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Disease, directed huge amounts of money to anyone who would do the research on HIV causing 30 separate conditions, including cervical cancer. He was the person that opened up and wrote the checks, and therefore you had to abide by his principles. He was also one of the ones, along with the FDA and other governmental agencies, that approved the use of AZT, the most toxic drug ever used. It was so toxic that the founder of that, the person that actually developed the National Cancer Institute, threw it on the junk pile of history because it was too toxic to use even in terminal cancer patients, yet we were using this on virtually anyone who tested positive for either the symptoms or the HIV virus, even if they were asymptomatic, meaning they had the virus, but they were otherwise healthy. And then if you read the package insert, you would have seen that the side effects from using AZT at 1,500 to 1,600 milligrams a day was AIDS-defining illness. So did they die and progress towards death with HIV as the cause, or the drug, or combination? And that was never a question that was asked, and you weren't allowed to ask it. There were topics that were simply off limits. Nobody could challenge anything that Anthony Fauci and Robert Gallo and others were doing when it came to HIV and AIDS. That was a mistake that cost us hundreds of thousands of lives in the United States and also worldwide millions. So this is the same Anthony Fauci heading today our war on the COVID virus. I want to share with you now some fully documented statements from a group of scientists and physicians in this particular paper, and it lays it all out. This is the Swiss Policy Research Studies on COVID-19 on its lethality. How dangerous is it? Here's what they're saying. And again, these are people who are not a part of discovering any vaccine, will not profit on it. They're not like Bill Gates, who could, having funded all these different companies, one of his companies or more will have the vaccine that will be used, and they'll try to make it mandatory. And they'll do the same thing that they did with weapons of mass destruction. They were wrong, led by the New York Times and Judith Miller. There were no weapons of mass destruction. And look at the devastation and the carnage from that. Nobody's ever apologized. Nobody was ever held accountable, and we've done nothing to clean up the mess we made. Now imagine that the vaccine industry has been indemnified, everybody associated with it has been indemnified, so nobody will have to pay any price for being wrong and giving toxic vaccines to people, and then 6 months, 6 days, or 6 years later, seeing the outcome, and all they can do is say, oops, well, enough of that. Because we've been down this road before. So expect in the very near future everyone in the media to sing from the same hymnal. The choir is, we've got a vaccine, it's been fast-tracked, don't worry about its safety or efficacy, there's enough evidence to warrant that we use it, the world stands in the balance, and it'll be pushed upon us and mandated. That's my concern. So here are some counterbalancing opinions. These are not lay people offering this. According to the latest immunological and serological studies, the overall lethality of COVID-19 is about 0.1%, and thus is in the range of a strong seasonal influenza. In countries like the United States and the United Kingdom and also Sweden, without a lockdown, overall mortality since the beginning of the year is in the range of a strong influenza season. Even in a global hotspots, the risk of death for the general population of school and working age people is typically in the range of what you would normally die from. So we're not seeing a spike in overall deaths. So however many people die in a given day, that's approximately how many would die and have died now. Up to 80% of all test positive persons remain symptom-free. So let's say you test positive. The normal reaction is, good, you tested positive, start taking these medications or these vaccines. Hold on a second. Where is the long-term study showing that if you test positive, you must be medicated? Wouldn't it make more sense to build up a person's immune system? Later in the program, I'm going to show you how that is done. But everything is going to be based on over-medicating, over-treating, even symptom zero people, meaning you're positive for the virus, but you have no symptoms. And by the way, that's even true among 70 to 79-year-olds. About 50% remain symptom-free. Over 95% of all people develop at most moderate symptoms. So those who do get sick get moderately sick. Up to 60% of all persons may already have a certain cellular background immunity to COVID-19 due to contact with previous coronaviruses, meaning all the common cold viruses. Remember, this is COVID-19. There have been 18 others, and no vaccine's ever been created for any of them. And so almost everybody in the world has had colds or flu. And how do we know, for example, when you're testing now, that it's specific just for COVID-19 and not one of the other COVID viruses that we've been affected by? The median age of the deceased in most countries, including Italy, is over 80 years of age. 86 years of age was the average death of COVID patients in Sweden, and only about 4% of the deceased had no serious preconditions. The age and risk profile of deaths thus essentially corresponds to normal life, meaning you're at the end of your life. If you have diseases, whether it's cancer, heart disease, emphysema, dementia, that is principally what you're dying from. And then up to 30% of all additional deaths may have been caused not by coronavirus 19, but by the effects of the lockdown and the panic and the fear and the depression that came from that. For example, the treatment of heart attacks and strokes decreased by up to 60% because patients no longer dared go to the hospital because they heard it. Every time someone went to the hospital and were tested, they had to wait in the hospital till the results came back, which could be a week or two, and you were exposed to both the staff and COVID patients. Well, if you have a serious comorbidity by being overweight, obese, heart disease, and cancer, you're going to stay at home. Well, that meant that the normal treatment that could have saved or prolonged lives was not implemented, and hence those people were at greater risk of dying and dead. Many media reports of young and healthy people dying of COVID-19 turn out to be false because many of these younger people also did not die of COVID-19. They already had some serious illness, like an undiagnosed leukemia, or they were in fact, let's say, along with other diseases in a poor state of immune system. In any case, strong increases in regional mortality can occur if there is a collapse in the care of the elderly and sick as a result of an infection or panic, or if there are additional risk factors such as severe air pollution. Now, I'll give you an example. The area of Italy that saw the worst deaths was the most polluted area of all of Europe. And air pollution itself has been shown and proven to be a risk factor for increasing your likelihood of dying from COVID-19. also the area was famous for people going there for assisted care, nursing homes. So these are people that were already sick, had multiple comorbidity factors in play, comorbidities, and they weren't tested to see, did they all have the COVID virus? And was the COVID virus responsible? It's one thing to have the COVID virus, another thing for the COVID virus to be proven it was the cause of death. That was never done. Right now, Italy's reexamining many of these early deaths to see, did they die from the COVID virus or from other comorbidities where the COVID virus was merely present? But everybody died of the COVID virus, we were told initially, before good science, epidemiology, histological, serological, and other studies were done to examine what did this person really die from. So there's just an example of why we have to be very confident in what we're saying before we say it, because it can scare people. What I want to do now, and by the way, on the air pollution, this is from The Guardian, and this is new. It says, quote, compelling evidence air pollution worsens COVID virus study. Exclusive best analysis to date indicates significant increases in infections, hospital admissions, and deaths with air pollution. So if you have bad air and you have the COVID virus, that bad air could contribute to your staying in the hospital or dying from the infection. So that's a problem, and we're not dealing with that. Also, another study that we should be concerned about, everybody's getting tested. A lot of people are getting tested. But how do we know the test is accurate? How do we know it's the best test that should be taken? This is from Business Wire, quote, CDC coronavirus test kits generate 30% false positives and 20% false negative results. Connecticut pathologist's newly published findings confirm. So, let's say someone comes in and they do not have COVID virus, and you give them a false positive. You say, yes, you do. And then you put them on a medicated protocol that could harm them or even kill them. We're not taking those people out of the statistics. All the people that died in nursing homes, including in New York State, thousands upon thousands died when the governor allowed people who were COVID positive and very sick in hospital to go into nursing homes, and they therefore infected everybody, and all those people were there to die. Well, they just died, and now it was all COVID. Well, that was over 55% of all deaths. So what if you took all those 55% of all deaths out of the equation? You're no longer in a pandemic. You no longer can justify the quarantining. If anyone should have been quarantined or should in the future be quarantined, it is the person that is most likely to have comorbidity and be infected with COVID virus. They should be kept at home or in a facility where COVID patients are not intermixed with patients who have serious life-threatening illnesses. A person who has life-threatening illness should be in a cared-for facility that treats them for their underlying illnesses. But healthy people, they shouldn't be in quarantine. They should be out working and living normal lives. Protecting themselves, yes. Proper hygiene, absolutely. I'll get to whether the studies have shown that the masks work or don't. There are positions on both sides. And even on social distancing, a Dr. Rudolf Hansel, who's an international scientist and a psychologist, and he says that better look at what happens when you isolate people because it can cause a whole series of its own problems, so that the only way a person can have any friends or relate is virtually over the internet, and that's extremely limiting. So, you know, isolation is not good. Now, to the mask question, I gave you on yesterday's program why masks should be worn and do protect you, based upon a careful look at the scientific literature. But now there is a counterbalancing effort to show that not all masks work. For example, quote, not a single randomized controlled trial with verifiable outcome has been able to detect a statistically significant advantage of wearing a mask versus not wearing a mask when it comes to preventing infection a viral illness. If there were any significant advantage to wearing masks to reduce infection risk to either the wearer or the others in the vicinity, then it would have been detected in at least one of these trials. Yet there's no sign of such benefit, and there's no evidence that masks are of any utility for preventing infection by either stopping the aerosol particles from coming out or from going in. You're not helping the people around you by wearing a mask, and you're not helping yourself avoid the disease by wearing a mask. Now, that is one view, and a doctor, Dennis Rancourt, a former professor of physics, is a researcher with the Ontario Civil Liberties Association in Canada, and he held that position for some time, and he's one of those voices. And he says that the controversial topic of face masks, should you wear one, when and where, does it protect you or not? There's a wide range of opinions on this, even within the health community. And so you have people divided, saying there is no scientific support for wearing a mask, and you have others saying there is good science showing wearing a mask. And my view is quite simple. I believe that proper hygiene should dictate. I mean, wearing gloves when you're out, that you can rewash and sanitize with some bleach so you can wear them again. And that's where you handle money, doorknobs, elevators, any surface areas anyone touches, you're protected. Also in your own environment, work environment or home environment, you can spray alcohol, 100% alcohol, and you can sanitize. Leave it on for 60 seconds before you rub it off. And then just be conscious. Now, if I'm going out someplace, I don't want to be around people coughing and sneezing. And when I'm on an airplane, I wear the highest protection there is, a N99 mask that I also spray on the inside outside with colloidal silver. So I believe that masks can help, but I believe that they must be the right protected mask. And the ones most people are wearing, which are these cheap cloth masks, I have not seen any scientific evidence that they're going to stop the very tiny particulate matter from getting into the mask. The better ones, yes. The ones people are making at home or the cheap ones, no. So wear a mask, but wear the right kind of mask. I think that's important. Also, we would never cough in someone's face or sneeze in someone's face, and we wouldn't want someone to do it to us, nor us to anyone else, because you're spreading particulate matter. One sneeze can project water droplets that will have the virus or bacteria in it, up to about 12 to 14 feet, some say longer, but that's what I've actually seen in the scientific literature. Normal conversation is about 3 to 6 feet. So therefore, any meeting I'm having, that person's 6 feet away and wearing a mask. It may not be comfortable, but at least it's safe. Now I'm going to play you some short clips. They're not the full clips, but I just want to show you some of the latest studies right up to date on antibodies, because right now we're told all the studies showing we're producing some antibodies and those antibodies are going to be good. How do you know? We used these studies where up to half the people in this study who were healthy, and they're only selecting healthy young people for these studies. That is a red flag, because you're going to be giving the vaccine to older sick people and young people who do not have fully or healthy developed immune systems. So you're not going to get an accurate reading if you're excluding everybody who would really possibly benefit from the vaccine. So also, we're seeing a lot of these people end up with side effects. So they're immediately discounting all the side effects, like nausea and dizziness and other conditions that could end up being severe in people who are not young and healthy, but older. It could put them in the hospital. Why isn't that being discussed by the media? Because the media is the choir now. So this is one study about why is everyone testing negative. And then a Swedish doctor, a little hard to understand, but you can get what she's saying. And this is the Karolinska Institute, so there's no politics or profiteering here. It's one of the most respected research centers and hospitals in the world. She's both a professor and a medical doctor and a research scientist. So she's talking about T-cell immunity and the truth about COVID-19 in Sweden. So let's Here are those, some of those, so you get an idea what's happening around the world now. And these are orthodox people, not alternative people. We'll go to the antibodies, COVID-19 antibodies. Why is everyone testing negative right now?
In my first film about the brutal long tail of COVID, I asked, what's going on? What is the virus doing to the body? And more recently, another question has come to prominence. Why are so many people who've had symptoms testing negative for antibodies? Well, I've got some data on that, and it's pretty surprising. Let's dive in. Anecdotally, we're seeing a lot of people testing negative for antibodies after experiencing symptoms compatible with a COVID infection. And I know of as yet unpublished studies at London teaching hospitals that are showing a surprisingly low proportion of staff testing positive for antibodies. And this is surprising because if you were working at a London hospital in March, good luck dodging the virus. And it's even a Google suggestion, which means lots of people everywhere are experiencing it and Googling in search of an answer. This is scary, right? Because if you've not got antibodies, what's to stop you catching the virus again? What's to stop us all riding a wretched coronavirus merry-go-round forever? And it's pretty much a bolt in the head for herd immunity too. But hold your horses. I don't know how I missed it, but this brilliant Forbes article was published on May the 27th, written by William Hasseltine, an extremely well-recognized ex-prof at Harvard Medical School. Google him, legit OG. Anyway, he discusses the way the body reacts to the SARS-CoV-2 virus. Essentially, upon infection, there are two major immune responses the body typically has. An antibody response, also known as a lymphoid response, and a cell-mediated response, also known as a myeloid response. What is this myeloid response? Well, myeloid cells attack the virus and the infected cells directly. Some myeloid cells engulf and destroy virus particles, others kill the infected cells directly, and others still induce a protective inflammatory response by release of compounds called cytokines. Remember where we've talked about an inflammatory response and cytokines before? Yep, post-viral fatigue. So what is it that the SARS-2 virus is doing differently than other coronaviruses to have this effect? The way SARS-2 affects both arms of the immune response is different. The lymphoid pathway is muted and the myeloid pathway hyperactive. This helps explain why some people who recover from COVID-19 have very low, sometimes undetectable levels of anti-SARS-2 antibodies. The consequential hyperactive myeloid response, on the other hand, can result in the famous cytokine storm associated with the rapid decline and death of COVID-19 patients. In dampening the antibody response to infection and ramping up production of chemokines, SARS-2 is amplifying what happens to us naturally as our immune systems age. In other words, infection by SARS-2 tips the balance of a misregulated immune system still further, explaining what we know all too well. Older people are at far higher risk of serious disease and dying from COVID-19 than the young. But while this hyperactive myeloid response might be deadly in the old, it's certainly having a profound effect in the young too. My feeling is that this is what we're seeing with the people out there, the 1 in 10 still suffering brutal fatigue well after a COVID infection and potentially the long tail of symptoms too. All seems to kind of make sense, right? But science needs more than just sense, it needs evidence. So let's take a look. Researchers at the Rockefeller University in New York looked at blood plasma samples from 149 patients. They discovered that most people who recover from a COVID infection generate a weak antibody response to SARS-2. Whilst patients' immune systems could generate the antibodies, they didn't necessarily make enough of them to neutralize the virus. In fact, the neutralizing effect was undetectable in 33% of the sample. So clearly, this battle against a SARS-2 infection is not being won entirely with a lymphoid or antibody response. And let's look at the accuracy of the two primary antibody tests being done in the UK, the Abbott test and the Roche test. We'll ignore the manufacturer's figures and instead look at Public Health England's independent tests. Here's the Abbott test. The specificity is very high, essentially 100%. This means that the risk of false positive is negligible, i.e. you can trust a positive result. But the sensitivity, not so much, 93%. This means that there is a significant risk of false negative, i.e. if your test comes back negative, that doesn't necessarily mean you've got no antibodies. And we can see here how that figure drops with time. For people who caught COVID in early mid-March, extrapolation would suggest you'd be looking at a 75 to 80% figure here for a negative result. And here's the Roche test, also very good at positive results, a high specificity. But not so much the negative ones. Overall, 15 of the 93 samples tested incorrectly negative. Interestingly though, in contrast to the Abbott test, the sensitivity increases as the interval increases. That is to say, if it's been a while since you had an infection, this data suggests you should go for the Roche test, not the Abbott one. What do these results tell us? Well, to understand, let's look at the way the tests are calibrated in the first place. The calibration of tests is done with the very sick in hospitals, potentially creating spectrum bias, and there have been studies done to investigate this. That means that the level of tolerance in these tests may not be set in the right place for those with more mild conditions, especially if those tests are done several weeks after the initial infection when antibody levels are starting to decline. Here's a graph of how the IgG antibody level declines over time. In some of these people, it may be declining under the test threshold that's been set too high due to the initial calibration using extremely sick patients.
Okay. Very interesting what they're saying. So how about the people who test and don't test for antibodies, but have been exposed to the virus? Can they still seed and spread it? Could they say, hey, I'm negative, and take their cells into an older person's environment? So here's what we do. We cannot prove at this moment that the antibodies are protective for everyone or they are lasting. Some statements are that they may only last 2 months or less. That means you'd have to get about 6 vaccines per year. No one's immune system should be exposed to that kind of assault. So wouldn't it make sense then to err on the side of caution that when you're around older people or sick people, simply wear a neck ionizer around your neck, as well as a high-level N95 to N99 mask? I think it would. Now let's hear from the Swedish doctor talking about T-cell immunity. You're going to hear more about this coming up.
Hello and welcome. This is Lockdown TV from Unheard. We hear a lot about T-cells these days, T-cell immunity. What does that actually mean? How confident should we be that it's a factor in the spread or non-spread of coronavirus? Well, here to discuss that with us is Dr. Sue Arleman from Stockholm. Hello, Dr. Arleman, can you hear me?
Hi.
So you are both a senior physician at the Karolinska Hospital in Stockholm, but also assistant professor at the Karolinska Institute, which is Sweden's medical research institute.
Yeah, that's right. So I'm working as a doctor to take care of the patients, and also because I'm a chief at the outpatient clinic now, taking care of the post-COVID patients and running clinical trials at the Karolinska University Hospital. And also I'm a researcher, so I'm doing more research, COVID research nowadays at the Karolinska Institute.
So really keen to get into the details of your new study. Came out last week, detailing some things you've discovered around the T cells and what that immunity actually means. But first, give us a sense of what the situation is in Sweden at the moment. It gets talked about a lot. What are you seeing in your hospital?
Yeah, so as we well known, I mean, we have had pretty high mortality rate in Sweden, especially compared to our Nordic countries. But if you look at the number of deaths and the number of patients being admitted to intensive care, I mean, the curve has been really steep in the beginning, from the March up to mid of April, and it also now goes, I mean, successfully really down. So I mean, it has been especially in the Stockholm region, and has been really local varieties. But now in Stockholm, which has been hit the most, we really see the downhill, and now intensive care units are getting empty. The wards are getting empty. Now we are closing down all this COVID wars. We are really, really seeing a decrease. And that despite, I think the people are really loosening up. Everybody is crowded on the beach, and I think the social distancing is not really kept very well. Nowadays, the more sunnier that it gets in Sweden, because it's not so does not happen so often. But still, I mean, the number of patients getting into hospital are really, really decreasing. That means, I think, it's some happening something else. It's not that we are getting harder lockdown or other measures, but I think we are getting closer to herd immunity. I cannot see any other reasons, because we are not really keeping the social distancing as good as in the beginning of the era.
You know, the official numbers for the antibody surveys are still relatively low. Even in Stockholm, it's under 20%, isn't it, that have shown bodies. So is it possible that everyone else is still equally vulnerable?
This is a totally new disease. So we don't know which fraction of the population need to have antibodies or T-cell immunity to have the herd immunity. When can the elderly come out from the isolation and be more comfortable not getting the contagious disease and deadly disease as soon as they come out? There's been modeling before, it was 70% or should be 50%, but now, at 10% maximum, antibodies, we are still seeing that our number of infections are decreasing really in March.
Do you feel like the epidemic is over in Stockholm?
No, it's not definitely not over, because we do have elderly still being isolated at home.
But there are some doctors who believe the tests are useless. Let's hear from them.
So do you know how the tests work? It's not a binary test, like a pregnancy test. It's called a PCR test, and it involves amplifying genetic material by doubling it in dozens of cycles until you have billions or trillions of the original molecules, and then using those results to determine if you have enough of the identified RNA fragment to be considered positive. Here's the thing. At a certain point of amplification, every single person would test positive. They use an arbitrary cutoff point where they stop doubling the material. That cutoff point is different amongst different tests for COVID-19. In fact, there were 10 different cutoff points amongst the 33 tests approved by the FDA. Seems a little strange, right? You might find it interesting that the Nobel Prize-winning inventor of the test did not believe it should be used to diagnose infectious illness. And perhaps you've heard about some of the problems with the test, such as the high rate of false positives. But in any case, let's say that after 37 times of doubling a specific genetic material they found in your body, they determine that you have enough of the RNA they are looking for to be considered positive.
I don't believe the numbers anyway, but the more you test and you're using the RT-PCR test, the person who developed this test, who won a Nobel Peace Prize, he himself said that you cannot use the RT-PCR to establish an infectious process. And the gold standard of seeing what the test is, because remember, there has to be a surrogate. For PCR to work, you have to have a surrogate test, you have to have a gold standard, and you test against it. It has never, ever been established. Now, I believe, if you look at and understand how the PCR works, they amplify it. They keep on amplifying it till you start seeing a certain number of whatever you're looking for, a certain number start to appear. I believe that at this point, they're going to continue to amplify the test to the point that everybody on this planet will test positive. Already, the Centers for Disease Control has come out and said that with the current testing that they're doing, they're not distinguishing between antibody titers, you know, serological markers, and virology. So serology and virology, they haven't distinguished that. They're kind of throwing all those numbers together. And the most interesting thing is that they've already established that they cannot rule out that if you've had a cold before, that you could test positive for COVID-19, which is what I said a couple of months ago based upon the cat study, that there were cats that had gotten the flu shot, never been exposed to COVID-19, and yet they were testing positive. So how many people on this planet have had a cold before?
Well, there are only a few methods of testing for COVID-19. Here they are. The first one is the most common. And remember, during the first 2 months, that's all there was. People were being diagnosed by symptoms only. The precise presentation of the seasonal flu, those are the symptoms that created this phenomenon that has brought the world to a halt. The second way of testing for COVID-19 antibody test, blood test looking for antibodies. Now, the problem with this is that the philosophy of observing antibodies in the blood has changed 180 degrees. 15 years ago, the presence of antibodies in the blood could mean that the person had just recovered from some health challenge and that their immune system had created antibodies, which was evidence of their recovery. Now, the presence of antibodies in the blood means that this patient is afflicted with a pathogen that is potentially fatal and is in need of some heroic treatment. So, this is the way the antibody testing for COVID-19 was conducted. They would take the blood sample. If they observed any kind of antibodies, whether they were viral or bacterial or whatever, they did not differentiate. That was a positive test for COVID-19. Any kind of unidentifiable viral or otherwise debris in the blood was also counted as a positive test. Okay, let's look at the third type of testing, the PCR, the polymerase chain reaction test. This is the test where you had to send a sputum sample into CDC, and then they would test it with the PCR test, and they would send you back the result, positive or negative. It's a completely unverifiable test, as we're going to see, and we're going to go into the specifics of why that is. Next came the test kits. Now, the test kits were only sent out about a month ago. They were sent out actually around the middle of March. The CDC sent the new test kits to hundreds of hospitals and clinics across the country, and these test kits were supposedly to screen out people for COVID-19. The problem is, when you look on the CDC website, it says right on the description, for experimental use only, not for diagnostic purposes. For experimental use only, not for diagnostic purposes. And then it says the CDC is making no claims for their validity. So after those test kits went out to all the hospitals about 3 weeks ago, that's when we saw this enormous spike. Because of course, right away, when the hospitals finally got a testing procedure that they didn't have to send in to, you know, Atlanta, they could report a lot more positive tests. The next thing that happened was, after those first test kits went out to the hospitals, the most recent thing that only happened a week or so ago now is the on-site test kits. And these supposedly are claiming to be able to take a sample from a patient and to screen them for COVID-19 in 5 or 10 minutes. This is completely ludicrous. It is impossible. It is scientifically untenable. These will not work at all. No one even claims that these on-site tests can validly differentiate anything, let alone COVID-19. They're completely unapproved and untested. And yet, the positive results from these unreliable tests are being included in the running total of COVID-19 cases being reported every day on the news. These are the main tests being used in this country today to count the numbers of positive cases we see enumerated on the daily scoreboard, not for diagnostic purposes. These are the only tests that are driving the daily numbers. The fact remains, none of these tests is scientifically verifiable and reproducible as a valid differentiation for COVID-19 specifically. They are all flawed and they're just estimates. Okay, so let's talk about the PCR a little bit more specifically here, okay? The polymerase chain reaction test was invented by Dr. Kerry Mullis from Berkeley in the early 80s. He won the Nobel Prize for inventing this test. This test is touted by the medical profession then and now as the gold standard for diagnosing microbial disease in patients. They claim that it can specifically differentiate any viral disease from any other viral disease by sequencing the RNA and DNA. This claim is constantly made even today, and it is completely insupportable and untrue. No one was more critical of the PCR test than its inventor, Dr. Mullis. It was disavowed from the very first. Here's what he said, quote, "Quantitative PCR is an oxymoron. PCR by its very nature is unsuited for estimating numbers. A common misimpression that the viral load tests actually count the number of viruses in the blood. These tests cannot detect free infectious viruses at all. They can only detect proteins that are believed, in some cases wrongly, to be unique to HIV. The tests can detect particles of viruses, but not viruses themselves," unquote. So you can read more about that quote in the February newsletter. He was embarrassed, exasperated for decades about the claims that organized medicine was making for his test. It simply does not do what they claim. The amazing thing is, such extravagant claims have been made over the past 40 years for the PCR test by organized medicine that there has been no other technology developed in that entire 40 years which claims to make any improvement on the ability of the PCR test to identify and sequence viruses and bacteria. Recently, I found this out that Dr. Mullis died a couple years ago because I would really want to interview him at this time. An interview with Carrie Mullis at this time would be extremely valuable. So with respect to the test kits that were sent out to the hospitals a month ago, this is the best kept secret. You can find no research, you can find no evidence, no description of how these test kits are supposed to work. It's a forbidden topic of discussion in corporate media, right? They were released by something called the EUA, an emergency use authorization from the FDA. These were brand new tests. They were unlicensed. They were untested. They were unproven. But because of the EUA, the emergency use authorization, this allows the use of all the unproven experimental test kits. Here's what they said. I actually read this somewhere. Quote, "There's no time to see if they work. That's an emergency."
This is an interesting take. A professor, Carol Sikora, highly respected professor, says that fear is more deadly than the virus. That's his opinion. Let's hear a few minutes what he has to say.
Thank you.
Very good. So you're a professor of medicine at the University of Buckingham. You were formerly the director of the World Health Organization Cancer Program. And you have become somewhat of a celebrity over the past few months by giving kind of reassuring and somewhat more positive news and commentary on the ongoing crisis. Let's dive straight in. There was a message you put on Twitter a few days ago that caught my eye, where you said that you thought there's a real chance the pandemic might burn out naturally. What did you mean by that?
If you look at the history of pandemics, from the Black Death through to the plague, through to more modern SARS and MERS that we've all experienced in our lifetime, they die out when people say they've died out. Of course, we're living with SARS and MERS, but we're not concerned about them. I feel the same thing will happen to the coronavirus. We will no longer be concerned. At the moment, we're consumed with it. The news is consumed with it. We're obsessed with body counts. Many of the people that have died, sadly, would have died anyway at exactly the same time. We're really quite taken in by the situation of the virus. And different countries have assumed different ways to police their people. Here, it's very British. It's a persuasive matter. In some countries, military police states, it's strictly enforced. And woe betide you if you break the isolation rules. So it is a fascinating way in which medicine, infection, the virus impinge on our freedoms as a society.
Mm. So there's the kind of, I guess, more social aspect of that. But on the medical side, what sort of evidence or how should we think about a virus dying out? I mean, in a sense, the policy is predicated on the presumption that if we stop with the social restrictions, it will come back and there'll be a big second spike and so on. Do you think that's a questionable assumption?
No, it's a valid assumption. We've heard a lot about the magic R0 number, which I last heard as a medical student 50 years ago. And now everybody can talk about, my kids talk about R0 to me. I mean, I've never seen anything like this. And there's no doubt that if the R0 goes up, the chances are the new infection rate will go up. But something's happened over just the last 2 weeks. The infection rate is going down, but the hospitalizations, certainly in the UK, have gone right down, and the deaths have gone right down. I mean, there's lots of little blips in it because of the way the data are counted. But there's no doubt things are getting better all over the world. Europe is opening up now. Austria, the first country to open up on the 14th of April, has had no second wave, no blip in increase, no problems epidemiologically with what's happened. The restaurants and cafes are beginning to open in Italy today, and hopefully there'll be no change. So, but we're all scared. And, you know, the political pressure on school teachers, on governments to try and sort out should children go back is one of the big discussion points this week. My point of view is that we've got to end the pandemic and we've got to end the psychology of fear that we've built up for this pandemic. People have to be responsible for their own actions. And as we move forward, I think that's what we're going to see.
But do you think there's a chance that as we gradually release restrictions, we don't see a second spike and we can actually return not to some sort of new normal where we continue social distancing in perpetuity, but actually just the old normal?
One of the more outspoken medical doctors in the United States is Dr. Pam Popper, and she has a response to what we're seeing with the over-medicalization and treatment and diagnosing of COVID-19.
But public health is not about preventing all deaths. That's the first thing I want to say. Public health is about mitigation, and mitigation means that there is no risk-free option. We tell people that in our office every day. There is no risk-free option. In other words, if you decide to have a screening test, there are risks associated with it. If you decide not to do it, there are risks. If you decide to take a drug, there are side effects. If you decide not to take it and you have a condition that and some people might think you should be drugged for, but the risk-benefit ratio doesn't look so good, there's a risk in not taking the drug. There is no risk-free option here. And to illustrate that point, I looked this up, you know, people screaming at me, there are 250,000 people who've died worldwide. Well, we know that there's been a lot of playing around with the numbers, and I'm going to talk about that in a minute. But 1.3 million people die of car accidents every single year worldwide, 1.3 million. So you might say, I get in the car and drive every day. Don't you care about people dying from car accidents? Why aren't you telling people not to drive? You're setting a bad example by driving. What's the matter with you, lady? I think we can understand that driving is not a risk-free option. And every day adults get in the car, or some teenagers, get in the car and realize that when you drive, you take a risk and you are willing to accept the risk associated with driving because the benefits outweigh the risks. And so that's what we should be doing in public health. And what's happened here, and I'm going to be talking about it later in the week, is that we have completely lost sight. We, the collective we, not me, not several individual people, but many of our health professionals have completely lost sight of the collateral damage while they're trying to make sure that nobody dies of COVID-19, and there's no way to ensure that, number one. And if we cause 2 or 3 or 10 or 20 times as many deaths on the other side, that's a risk-benefit ratio that makes absolutely no sense in public health, all right? So anyway, the last thing I'll say about this is make sure when you ask me for information that you've looked at the newsletters and read the video, watched the video clips, because a lot of the things you ask about I've already covered, and I'm trying to cover new stuff as it comes up rather than go back over the old stuff. All right, so couple things coming up. Thursday, May 28th is our next free intro workshop on pampopper@msn.com. If you're interested in our free stuff, which also includes a weekly newsletter, free trial membership, we have, and we'll send non-subscribers who become subscribers all the past issues of the newsletter. We don't send them out individually every week. Don't ask us to do that. And then if you're interested in careers, lots of you are thinking about a career change, particularly some of you who are in healthcare. And some of you who aren't in healthcare really want to become part of the solution to all of this nonsense that's going on. So pampopper@msn.com, I'll send you information, happy to schedule a phone call with you. And summer semester starts next week. The Diet and Lifestyle Intervention course is a magnificent 15-module course that covers everything from basic research to modules that include women's health, men's health, children's health, vaccinations, cancer, autoimmune diseases, gastrointestinal diseases, etc. It's a good overview course. And also, dietary intervention in employer and other group settings, food service and institutional settings, psychology, which will include communication, teaching skills, and problem solving. And so lots of stuff going on here. And if you're interested in any of it, send me an email. And of course, I'm interested in your comments. I'm particularly interested in people who want to have a civil discussion. So let's talk about ginning up the COVID death rate. We'll start with Illinois. Some of the most draconian lockdown measures are in Illinois. As it turns out, the numbers used to justify the lockdown are manipulated as per instructions issued by the CDC. On April 20th, 2020, the Illinois Department of Health Director, Dr. Ngozi Ezike, explained how her department decides whether or not a death is due to COVID-19. She said that anyone who dies and has tested positive is categorized as a COVID death. So you get hit by a bus, the trauma kills you, but you're COVID-19 positive. Death certificate says death by COVID. Okay, we call that misrepresentation where I come from. I'm gonna read to you verbatim what she said. Quote, if you were in hospice and had already been given a few weeks to live, and then you were also found to have COVID, that would be counted as a COVID death. It means technically, even if you died of a clear alternative cause, but you had COVID at the same time, it's still listed as a COVID death. So everyone who's listed as a COVID death doesn't mean that was the cause of the death, but they had COVID at the time of the death. So I find that an interesting quote. Those were her words directly. You can go online and read this. So she basically said, whether or not they died of COVID, we're gonna count it as a COVID death. So they could have died of something else, but we still put it on the death certificate, because in the world of public health in Illinois, telling the truth is obviously not part of the culture there. Even while using falsified death certificates, state health officials acknowledged on April 20th that the number of cases and deaths is decreasing, yet today in late May, the state remains locked down by the emperor of Illinois, Jay Pritzker. I have some more to say about him later in the week. Colorado State Representative Mark Baisley has asked for a formal investigation into Jill Ryan, executive director of the Colorado Department of Public Health and Environment, with the potential for criminal charges to be brought. According to Baisley, Ryan has falsely altered death certificates. This is even one step further than the nitwit in Illinois. Baisley provided a letter from the Summer and Glen Senior Care Facility, which was sent to its staff, residents, and families of residents, stating that the Colorado Public Health Department had changed the cause of death recorded by the attending physicians in 7 cases to reflect COVID-19 instead of the actual cause of death. In other words, in this case, what happened is the Department of Health overrode and changed it once a physician had signed off on it. The Montezuma County Coroner told the same news station that reported this, that the state overruled the cause of death for a person in his jurisdiction too. The person died of alcohol poisoning, but it was changed to COVID-19. So I guess the deal is that in order to make the numbers sound terrible, we do whatever we have to do, including forgery, falsification, actually changing the thing on the death certificate, the entry. It's pretty incredible. Eventually, the Colorado Department of Health actually acknowledged that the numbers had been inflated by people who had the virus but died of other causes and by falsified death certificates, and adjusted the numbers down from 1,150 deaths to 878. Now, remember Dr. Deborah Birx, who looked into the camera and told everybody to follow the CDC's directions and falsify death certificates? Yeah, her. She's changed her mind about that. Just a few weeks ago, during one of the White House press briefings, she directly said, and there was a fuss about it. I mean, we got calls from doctors who said, I have to do this or lose my job, but I resent being told that I have to lie in order to keep my job. So now she's saying the opposite. She's asked the CDC to exclude from the death count people who had the virus but died of something else, and also to remove those who were presumed to have the virus but did not have confirmed lab results. Birx and other health officials now are taking issue with the CDC's system, claiming that the number of cases and mortality may be inflated by as much as 25%. She said, quote, "There is nothing from the CDC that I can trust." Gosh, she used to love these people. She used to lie for these people. Not surprisingly, the CDC is refusing to alter their numbers. Bob Anderson, chief of mortality statistics branch of the CDC's National Center for Health Statistics, says that the numbers are actually underreported. Well, how can that be? The number of cases includes people who were never confirmed to have COVID, and the number of deaths includes people who died of something else, and he's still going to look into the camera and claim that the deaths are underreported. I mean, it's really kind of amazing. Another person who thinks that the numbers are underreported is Anthony Fauci. Again, what part of this does he not understand, and why does he have a job? And something else I want to point out, I don't know if you've noticed, this is very interesting to me, that over the course of this whole thing, there were a couple of high-profile child deaths, which were the medical examiners in the two states where this happened refused to sign off on as a COVID death. They just refused. The record was never corrected.
One of the most egregious things that has occurred in this pandemic is the falsification of how many deaths we have, since we seem to be almost back in 1968 and counting deaths in Vietnam, body counts. So how many people test positive? But what if they test positive and are otherwise completely healthy, which is the vast majority of people? But we're thinking if they test positive, that automatically means they're susceptible to being able to die from that, which is not the case unless you're already compromised in your immune system. But when a Montana physician, Dr. Annie Bukasek, talks about being told, no matter what a person died from, falsify the death certificate, which are all being manipulated to make it COVID, that means that there are people behind the scenes who need to have a high death count to justify their draconian, even totalitarian way of handling what is coming to us, which is a mandatory vaccine. So let's hear what she has to say.
I make sure I don't give excessive commentary. So I'm going to talk about death certificates today. The decision for unprecedented government mandated lockdowns has been based on the alleged death rate of COVID-19. Is this death rate based on truth? I posted the following question on Facebook yesterday. This is the question. Know anybody personally with baseline good health who has been hospitalized for COVID-19 alone or allegedly died from COVID-19? That was my question. I asked the question this way because if you know someone personally, you may know their baseline health status and some details of the case. And being tested positive for COVID-19 does not mean you have the disease. Even asking the question this specifically, I still got some people saying their spouse knows a friend of a friend who's of a nephew in New York. And some who answered yes, but didn't give the details, even though I asked them, could you please submit some more details? I got over 350 comments and received dozens of no answers, if not scores. Last I counted, there were three or four who answered yes and said their case fit the criteria, and they gave me some details. But even those three or four, giving them the benefit of the doubt that they were answering honestly to the best of their knowledge, does that mean the person they described was actually stricken with COVID-19? Inquiring minds want to know, are the reported deaths from COVID-19 truly deaths from COVID-19? To address this question, we need to discuss death certificates, since death certificates are the basic source of information about mortality. The discussion of death certificates is not a fun one. We have all grieved so many losses in our lifetimes. Still, we need to talk about it because they are the basis of the so-called death rate of COVID-19. History-changing decisions are being made due to these figures, despite the fact that they are flat out wrong, based on data that is insufficient and often inaccurate. Few people know how much individual power and leeway is given to the physician, coroner, or medical examiner signing the death certificate. How do I know this? I've been filling out death certificates for over 30 years. More often than we want to admit, we don't know with certainty the cause of death when we fill out death certificates. That is just life. We are doctors, not God. Autopsies are rarely performed, and even when an autopsy is done, the actual cause of death is not always clear. Physicians make their best guesstimate and fill out the form. Then that listed cause of death, whatever we list, is entered into a vital records data bank to use for statistical analysis, which then gives out inaccurate numbers, as you can imagine. Those inaccurate numbers then become accepted as factual information, even though much of it is false. So, even before we heard of COVID-19, death certificates were based on assumptions and educated guesses that go unquestioned. When it comes to COVID-19, there is the additional data skewer that is, get this, there is no universal definition of COVID-19 death. The Center for Disease Control, updated from yesterday, April 4th, still states that mortality, quote unquote, data includes both confirmed and presumptive positive cases of COVID-19. That's from their website. Translation, the CDC counts both true COVID-19 cases and speculative guesses of COVID-19 the same. They call it death by COVID-19. They automatically overestimate the real death numbers by their own admission. Prior to COVID-19, people were more likely to get an accurate cause of death written on their death certificate if they died in the hospital. Why more accurate when a patient dies in the hospital? Because hospital staff has physical exam findings, labs, radiologic studies, etc., to make a good educated guess. It is estimated that 60% of people die in the hospital. But even those in hospital deaths, the cause of death is not always clear, especially in someone with multiple health conditions, each of which could cause the death. Clear-cut causes of death might include traumatic brain injury, say from a car accident, intractable seizures or asthma, sepsis from overwhelming infection, respiratory arrest from a COPD exacerbation, ruptured aneurysm, metastatic cancer, massive acute heart attack, stroke, or pulmonary embolism. I will talk more in a little bit about why inaccuracy in the cause of death has declined for hospital deaths with the introduction of COVID-19 testing. There are also unclear causes of death in ambulances. That's a reality. An example would be someone with multiple deadly conditions who gets short of breath and dies before evaluation can be done. Was it the patient's underlying lung disease or heart disease that caused the shortness of breath, that caused them to call the ambulance? Or was there a concomitant pneumonia or other problem? We don't know because the patient died before the incident could be evaluated. So an estimated 60% of people die in the hospital. As to the other 40%, it is estimated about 20% of people die at home and 20% in nursing homes in this country. The true cause of death in these situations usually remains unknown. The death certificate is filled out with the best educated guess. Unknown causes of death include elderly people or younger people with known heart disease who die peacefully in their sleep. It is not acceptable to list old age as a cause of death, even though that may be more accurate than the cause of death we often list on the death certificate. We are allowed to state as a cause of death atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, and that may be our best guess in a lot of these cases. But is it truly the cause? Who knows? Only God in heaven knows. Amen? So allow me to give a real-world example. One of my patients' fathers died about 17 years ago. He was old and in the final days of terminal cancer. He also had heart disease, but was too old and too sick to get heart bypass surgery. As he got near the end of his life, he came down with what appeared to be pneumonia. As my patient, this man's son, stood by his father's sickbed at home, the man died. No one else was there. The mortician was called and removed the body at about 2 a.m. The next day, the funeral home called and asked my patient, the son of this man, what time did he die and what was the cause? The death certificate listed the man's son's best guess. The cause of death made by the deceased man's son was made official. He was cremated, so there was no second opinion. This man didn't even have any medical training that gave the diagnosis to the mortician. This happens all the time, especially in poor urban areas, casual country towns, and rural areas. In the case of my patient's father, did an accurate cause of death matter? Not really. But today, when governments are making massive changes that affect our constitutional rights, and those changes are based on inaccurate statistics, it does matter. There's a U.S. standard for death certificates that includes a line for immediate cause of death, followed by 2 to 3 lines of antecedent causes, giving rise to the immediate cause, then 1 to 2 lines of other significant conditions contributing to the death, but not causally related to the immediate cause.
Thank you all for listening. I'm Gary Nall. Have a nice day.